It's been great meeting people. It's just good to meet the audience. You know, when you work in a dark shed somewhere at a distant end of space, you don't have the audience there to appreciate the work. And so you come to a place like this, and especially for shows like Farscape and Stargate, which 15 and 20 years old, to see people that grew up on it, people have come to it in the last couple of years, it's kind of remarkable. Look, Farscape has the Henson Company stamp on it in the first place. They do great stuff. It also was groundbreaking for its time. It was science fiction with focused on a human edge and on relationships, which at the time science fiction was, especially space science fiction, was more space opera designed in a sort of militaristic bent, and Farscape wasn't that. It was really about the relationships. So I think that's one of the things that helps it endure. That and the fact that you've got all the Creature Shop prosthetics, and you've got the Henson Company puppeteers and animatronics. So, you know, it's a good-looking show. It's an interesting show. SG1, one of the great things about it is that it has from the very beginning, it has a great team. You had great writers and directors, but the actors, Richard Dean Anderson, Michael Shanks, Amanda Tapping, Chris Judge, they created a great team that you want to watch and follow and go through the gate to these other worlds. So, you know, from my memory of it, when I came on board, I was just wanting to integrate with the team, and what I found was there's a lot of very bright and personable people to spend your days working with. And we, you know, had Claudia Black and Bo Bridges and, you know, the host of people that came and went on that show. It's a tremendous amount of talented people to be surrounded by. The thing that I'm proudest of is that I think that when I came on board, there wasn't a fracturing of the team, that, you know, that there was it was a cohesive group that you could still follow. So, you know, that's more of a credit to the people that accepted me into their home than it is for me, but I'm glad they accepted me in.
Talk a little bit about your experiences working with, I guess, particularly Elizabeth Debicki on Guardians of the Galaxy Volume 2.
Yeah, well, I mean, Elizabeth's she's a tall, gorgeous Australian girl. Not much to complain about there. She's also an exceedingly talented actress. And so I got the privilege, basically, of standing next to her and having small chat. The Guardians of the Galaxy is just a really great piece of film. You know, it's an enjoyable piece of film. It's a break from the Marvel mode in some ways, but James Gunn, who directed it, is kind of a genius. So, you know, being in that environment and being with those people was very exciting for me.
Do you think you might be back for Guardians 3? Is that something you'd like if you were given the opportunity, maybe for a bigger role next time?
I would be happy to work on anything that James Gunn does. I'm happy to be working with Marvel in any capacity. So the simple answer is, yeah, I would love to be back. But that's, one, that's a question I can't answer. And two, if I could answer, I probably couldn't answer because of how of how tight Marvel keeps their stories together. So, you know, that's a question for other people above my pay grade. Science fiction allows you to ask the big questions. It allows you to expose extremes and extreme situations without necessarily getting dark, violent, or nasty. Science fiction is at its best is an examination of our humanity. Most of the great science fiction books, which are really great, at their core, it's an exploration of who we are and where will we end up. You know, it's not quite often it's not a dystopian view of the world and not always a utopian view of the world, but it's an examination of where we're going to go. And you know, if you live long enough, which to a certain degree I already have, you know, we've gone from a stage where information was fairly limited and hard to get, and you had to get it from people who were experts, to a world where everybody carries around a what would 30 years ago be considered a massively powerful computer in their pocket and in their ear at all times. You know, we're heading to a stage of augmented reality, and the way that we view the world has changed because science has changed us. And that's the essence and core of speculative science fiction, or speculative fiction full stop. So, you know, I think that, you know, there's always been a great popularity for it. The advances in technology have made it such that we can produce it at a higher level on a more consistent basis than was once required. The amount of resources that was thrown at 2001 by Kubrick was immense. And these days that can be done for a fraction of the cost and expense and artistic necessity to generate than was once required. So when science fiction was in the ghetto, even though people loved it, a lot of it was B science fiction, and it was considered pulp. And right now, I think there's a fair argument to be made that science fiction in television and film might be the highest form of art collectively being produced in the world today. And if you look at something like Guardians of the Galaxy Volume 1 and Volume 2, and understand how much artistic effort and human effort and creativity and intelligence which is applied to just make that movie, I think, you know, you have a fair case for, wow, that's like building the pyramids.